and thank you for meeting us back here for game number 4, Golden Guardians versus Clutch Gaming. And it does not matter how things shook out up until this point, because both team seasons come down to how this matchup goes.
That's right. Winner here makes it into playoffs. Simple as that. The loser also will still have a chance because they go to a tiebreaker. So both these teams still have a lot of hope for the day. Golden Guardians, they should be coming into this a little bit scared due to what happened yesterday. I mean, honestly, they did not play like a cohesive unit, and specifically, they didn't play around their fed Haunter, the Tristana in the top lane that they picked for that big lane bully, got him ahead, and then they kind of spread up. So they really do need to, you know, bring that cohesiveness back together for this matchup. Because this opponent today is going to be one that looks to attack you and split you up. Clutch Gaming have done a good job at pushing tempo in their games. Yesterday they did it with the Leona pick. They've done a lot of Assassin's mid, and they could very well try and speed this one up.
Well, we've made our way into Champion Select, taking a look at how the bans are going through. Yuumi and Ezreal banned out by Clutch Gaming. Yumi's a really common ban. Ezreal is not. They want to keep that one specifically away from FBI. And also, so much respect banning the Karthus out first round, specifically against Froggen because of what he's done on the champion in the past. Golden Guardians, some more typical bans in the Akali and the Sylas. Rakan, a bit more unusual, but trying to keep that away from Vulcan, who has had success on that champion.
Yeah, I mean, they banned away the Karthus. The Anivia still up, and we saw what it did last game, Flowers.
Yes, we did.
The Ezreal, though, I think I agree with that ban versus FBI. A pretty big pick for them. It allowed their bottom lane to play super well so far. Let's see. With the Aatrox and Braum, very quick lock-ins here, though, for Golden Guardians. That signals team fighting.
Yeah,
Aatrox
exactly.
Is amazing damage for those team fights. Huge AoE, still brings a lot of tankiness as well with the increased self-healing and lower cooldown on the ultimate, despite losing the revive mechanic.
Yeah, I was going to mention the revive. This champion has taken the nerf bat so many times since his initial rework, and he just keeps hanging on to his spot in pro play. Not pick ban tier anymore, but still incredibly powerful in the right hands. We'll see if Haunter can get fed on him again here this time around. They will be going up against a Sivir in the bottom lane. We'll see if they want to put Damante on Qiyana. Remember, he was the one who got the first win on this champion in LCS. Do they trust that to be what carries them in this game that matters so much? Right now, they're going to put the pause on that, go with the Nautilus instead for the support role.
Yeah, I think you want to see some more of the team that they're facing, because let me remind you, he also got the first Qiyana loss in the LCS.
That's very true. That's very true.
Double-edged sword there. Let's see. They lock in some more tankiness instead. Nautilus, Sivir, consistent bottom lane. We get to see it once again already. Sivir very good at the wave clear. Nautilus looking for all-ins. Yep. So Clutch Gaming already have a very good front line. Jarvan and Nautilus are pretty reliable hard engage with the speed ups from Sivir.
And I really like having a point and click powerful CC like the Nautilus ultimate going up against Kalista, because this is a champion that has the ability to kite everyone around in a circle, but she will have to outplay that Nautilus ultimate to successfully do it.
I love seeing Kalista, and especially versus Sivir, so good with the Rens, with controlling the lane early on. It can be extremely deadly. Braum and Kalista is definitely a kill lane. She can chase you down with just one of the slows landing. They can stack up those Braum passives by himself and be able to layer it pretty easily. Let's see here. Braum also, you know, able to pop so many of Sivir's damage abilities. Able to stop the bounces as well as the boomerang blade. Qiyana banned out there, so not going to see that one this time around.
Yeah, Qiyana's banned away, Gangplank's banned away, and Clutch Gaming continue to pay tribute to Froggen in the mid lane with two more targeted bans in the Anivia and the Vel'Koz, really recognizing who is all too often the win condition of Golden Guardians and trying to keep that offline. Golden Guardians do have the last couple of picks. I fully expect pick number 5 to be saved and reserved for Froggen, which it is, as the Gragas is locked in for the jump.
All right, Gragas definitely can make some super early moves. Brings AP threat, by the way, which is very much needed. When you have the Aatrox already locked in, you want a little bit more of a balanced damage type. I think that may have been another deciding factor between the Sejuani-Gragas little switch there. Sejuani mostly does AD. Rumble locked in for Hooney once again, though. His most consistent champion. He's played it every year that he has played in Professional League of Legends. Brings so much of that AP damage that they would be lacking. He is going to be the sole source, basically.
But remember, it could actually be a flex. We could see Rumble mid with Irelia top as well.
Yeah,
is that potential?
And Hooney is on the team. I'm expecting the Rumble in Hooney's hands. Also, right. Damante had an amazing Irelia game yesterday. Really did like a lot of his choices as far as ult flashing and ignoring low priority targets to go for the back line.
Well, we've got Tristana as the final pick here for the side of Golden Guardians. So mid lane Trist against Irelia can be very scary if Irelia gets ahead.
Yeah, and that is, again, why we are considering the Gragas lock-in to be a lot in the value of the AP damage type there so that they're not full AD. Both teams going to be mostly AD, though, and Tristana, once again, such a strong early lane. And because she's a lane bully, plus has the explosive charge there, you can get a lot of turret play money early on. Looks like Golden Guardians could have a very, very fiery early game, considering their bottom duo match as well. I expect some jungle opportunities to come up very, very early in this game.
Yeah, Golden Guardians, you say they could have a fiery early game, but at the same time, if they don't get off to a good start, you're looking at a team that has a jungler who, in this day and age, builds AP. You've got a fighter top laner and 280 carries. If Clutch Gaming, particularly Hooney, gets ahead and he drops an equalizer on that comp, sayonara.
Hooney definitely has the opportunities for some game-changing ultimates. Has been true of his Rumble in the past. Who's gonna make it? You win this game, you're in playoffs. Golden Guardians and Clutch want to end their weekend now so they don't have to play for tiebreakers.
Oh, you best believe whoever loses this one will have to play in the final tiebreaker of the day up against whoever wins the first tiebreaker of Optic versus 100 Thieves. So it's going to be a long wait trying to review what went wrong and what you've got to change and how you have to step up in that last final chance. But there's no reason to worry about it if you just take the Nexus here. We're out onto the Rift. Teams are fanning out into that line of scrimmage here at level one. Frog and an FBI hanging out together here in the river. We'll see if they go for the invade here. Tribrush is going to be checked here by three members of Golden Guardians with the Tristana over the wall. Could Rocket jump in to join the fight if needs to?
Ooh, and they sweep her over the inside ward behind Dragon Pit here, continuing on with the invade.
All right, as the invade doesn't seem like it's leading towards any violence here just yet, the Tigress is standing by with Jimmy for a sideline report, but we're gonna have to wait here just a second. Who's gonna be in some trouble? Let's see, it's Hoo-He barely getting himself away. Winter's Bite is gonna buy him enough time, but the Golden Guardians will disengage. And now that we're heading back to base, Jarvan, stop messing with him for a second. We got a sideline report to check in on the Tigress. Please, take it away.
Already getting frisky over on the Rift, but my oh my, I have to get your wards going into this through the draft. Clearly a bit of targeting against some of your traditional picks. So how are you feeling confidence-wise in what you ended up with?
I think you called it pretty well. It seems like a pretty frisky draft. We have a pretty clear plan for what we want to do. We want to be aggressive. We want to fight. So I'm happy with what we got.
One of the interesting things about today is there's always an extra element of pressure because of the potentials of tiebreakers. Is that affecting you at all here today?
Not in the least. We're really focused on Clutch right now. I know it sounds cliche, you know, one game at a time, but that's definitely how we feel right now. We're not really thinking about anyone else.
Well, I'm ready for more of that hot, hot heat in this game. So casters, take it back.
Eyes on the prize. They're focused all up on the moment at hand. And honestly, no reason not to be. You win it here, you don't got to worry about the rest. We already said that. I want to see both of these teams really get things together because we've honestly seen so many highs and lows from both squads over the course of the split. That's what you can expect when they're both sitting at such a middle of the pack state like this. And going into playoffs, you need to be hitting those high notes.
Yeah. I don't think I've ever in my life heard any team answer with they're not focused on the game that they're playing right now.
Yeah, we're not worried about this one.
At least they don't admit to it.
Yeah, exactly. Hearing we're not too worried about this one isn't exactly good form when it comes to an interview. But right now, I want to keep an eye on Frog and 2 throughout this laning phase because the Tristana is still a champion that we're only starting to see, really. Only came out recently being played in solo lanes. People sort of finding this new way to go about using the champion. So I like seeing players who have historically been the successful carry on their team, like Froggen, and seeing what they can do with it. Can you carry everybody using this new age Tristana style of playing into the solo lane? Because right now, Demonte is just hanging back. He knows he can't contest that range early on.
Yeah, and it's not. There's nothing like crazy about it. It's literally just Tristana with more experience and more gold. So you level up your range from your passive quicker, because that is level-based, and you get a lot more damage early on. Tristana also, as far as range carries go, has a lot of defenses built into the kit, so it's well-equipped for solo lane play with the rocket jump, with the ultimate buster shot as well to knock people away. Meanwhile, on the top side, Huni on the signature rumble, trying to turn up that heat, pushing Ponser under the turret, trying to deny some CS that way.
You mentioned as we were getting into this game, it was Ponser yesterday playing the Tristana, getting ahead, the Golden Guardians failing to play around him as a team. Let's see if he can get as fed on the Aatrox here this time.
Well, yeah, they've made the easy switch. They're like, you know what? Since we always play around Froggen, let's just switch the Tristana over to Froggen.
Yeah.
They won't have to switch their gameplay.
Then it's easy to play around the Tristana.
There you go. Currently, Froggen also with a small CS lead for himself, has also forced Demonte back to base early on. Lyra waiting for a possible gank on bottom side, but nothing, no opportunity really comes up. Ponser with a nice Q3 there as the Infernal Chain pulls him back.
Yeah, the Q3 landed in time to not be absorbed by Huni's shield, and at the same time, Huni using the shield overheated him, so he was not able to strike back and get anything on the back into that trade. Things go the way of Ponser there. Back in the bottom side, farm staying pretty much even here between Sivir and Kalista. Neither jungler having a lot of success interfering with the lanes just yet, but Contrax is making his way towards his top side. He's got the Predator ready to go. He's already popped that one. Going after Huni now. Flash is available, and Contrax will immediately pull away.
Predator used. Huni walks back. And that is the end of that story. This is what wards will do for you. This one right here. And immediate reaction from Huni does get him out of danger. No summoner spells used, just the Predator active. But that is a fairly decent tool for Gragas early on in this game. And it also signals to Lyra that the Gragas is on the top side of the map. So this gives Lyra full authority to go invade here, especially since the bottom lane is pushed up. Vulcan's able to invade, and they go get this deep ward inside the jungle down, make some good use of their time.
Yep, getting the ward down, but not taking any camps away as part of that opportunity. Lyra still with a slight CS advantage over his opponent, about one camp up. Remember, all jungle camps do always give 4 CS. Demonte is going to continue sitting underneath his turret here as Huni drops the Equalizer to make sure Haunter doesn't take the trade any further.
Yeah, gets the whole minion wave with it as well. Maybe he's going for a back here? Gonna hard shove as well. Lyra now looking, eyes on mid lane. Level 6s now for both of these mid laners, and the junglers are circling.
But you already mentioned it, how easy it is for Tristana to escape ganks, especially from somebody like Jarvan who has to land the skill shot. You just rocket jump away from it.
Buster shot super effective as well. And Lyra gonna be able to pick up that scuttle crab. Dragon is available, so Lyra has to be careful about showing on top side too much at this stage of the game, because it's definitely possible with a Kalista on the team, even though they nerfed a bit of the neutral monster damage for her Rend, still very powerful in assisting with that dragon control. It's one of the things that Kalista does very well.
Yes, sir.
You can stack up the Rend super well on the dragon. Also, as I was talking about in Champ Select, Rend is really good versus Sivir because it's insanely hard for Sivir to predict when you're going to pull the spears out and Rend. And you get to continue to stack them up for a very long time.
Pretty much the opposite of what we saw last game with the new snowballs being so telegraphed. It's very easy for Sivir to always collect the mana and avoid the CC off of those procs. I want to keep an eye on FBI, see what he can do with that as we're moving forward. Almost level 6 here for all 4 bottom laners. Vulcan, you can see, roaming up towards the mid lane just in case this turns into any action. Neither side has found the opportunity to make a play for First Blood just yet. But Clutch Gaming are trying to maintain control over this river. See Vulcan walking around trying to put down some wards, clear out some of whatever the Golden Guardians have sitting around. Lyra will start up the Cloud Drake here. See if he decides to finish the entire thing off. Vulcan and Cody Sun do have control and priority over bottom side. They'll shove that wave up, they'll rotate over to help Lyra, and this should be a free Drake for Clutch Gaming.
Yeah, I really, really want to highlight the minimap for this one, because this was a double winning lane dragon. both mid and bottom push all the way up. So that means there is no possibility of an answer from Golden Guardians. It is Lyra supported by both surrounding lanes to get that objective. Bottom side, they're going for a gank though.
Now the counterattack's coming out. Whohi goes forward. They're not quite able to stun up Vulcan. He gets away with use of the flash, and that means Contrax will once again use the Predator, but find nothing.
Yeah, very, very necessary flash there from Vulcan to get out of that. He was definitely going to go down if he gets stunned up there. So trade of support flashes that both junglers will have their eyes on. As you said, though, another Predator active use for Contrax. They aren't able to find any true advantage out of it. And now Lyra is looking to punish the offensively blown summoner. Level 6s start to come in, and Contrax circling around the back as well.
Golden Guardians thinking about maybe setting up a dive here, and with Contrax coming around from behind, it's going to be a 3v3 that the Golden Guardians are not quite expecting. Contrax running into Lyra there in the brush. Vulcan's burning away, but he will barely walk out. Contrax now going to be tanking up a lot of damage. Lyra taken down to 200. Demonte rotating around, trying to join the fight before it's too late. Hoonies dropped the equalizer. FBI is down, and first blood goes to Clutch Gaming. They're still looking to find even more off the back end of it, but they will not be able to chase down the rest of the Golden Guardians.
Yeah, Clutch had the extra person because Hoonie teleports down. Froggen doesn't have teleport on the Tristana. So it's a 5v4 play for Clutch. They get the kill. Froggen pushes mid lane, though. You see how many of these turret plates the Tristana can get. And he's got another wave into the turret. This thing's going down. Another explosive charge right on that thing.
Froggen, though. All right, still manages to get himself away. There's that mobility, those escape mechanisms you were talking about. Clutch Gaming cannot collapse in time. Monster still trying to walk himself out of this one. Hoonie's in hot pursuit.
Ooh.
But the Golden Guardians are waiting over the wall, and Hoonie has to flash back. The flash for an ignite. But now the Clutch Gaming counterattack is alive and well. Demonte grabs a kill, and Clutch Gaming cannot get their jungler out alive. That'll be at least a 1-for-1, and Golden Guardians are on the board.
Both junglers down here. That was a pretty nice pickup there initially. And some slick moves from Demonte to get to the outside, but Golden Guardian strike right back. All right, let's see. One kill, that one going over to Aatrox. So Haunter here going to have a little bit of extra money. They do cancel Hoonie's recall as well. Kalista ultimate was used.
That was a little ambitious.
Mm-hmm.
Not going to find the mark on that, but Froggen continues going forward after Demonte here. Vulcan with a long-range hook onto the enemy mid laner. Still looking to find the damage here. One more auto attack should seal the deal. And a good stopwatch coming out from Vulcan, just trying to buy a little bit of extra time. Haunter versus Demonte, not going to stay a fair fight here for very long. Demonte not going to find the stun. But with Lyra showing up, they should have the follow-up they need. The Skirmisher's Saber Smite is down, and that's another kill going the way of Clutch Gaming.
Yeah, I thought another challenger was about to approach, but Hunter's already dead, so nothing left for Contrax to get except for the minions. That leaves bottom tower open for Cody Sun, and he'll finish it off.
Cody Sun giving Clutch yet another advantage. First turret going their way just 11 minutes in. That means you got 5 full plates worth of money on it, too. That's 800 gold by itself.
All right, let's take another look here. I have to say, Demonte on this Aurelia uses the minions really well to dodge a lot of things. You see there, he stunned Haunter, so he couldn't get in place quite quick enough, and Vulcan was able to get the hook past Haunter. Then Demonte uses the reset on the Q on that low melee minion to get right up to Frog and finishes him off. And since he knows Lyra is in the area, he takes the 1v1 with the solo laner, knowing it will turn into a 2v1 and uses another low health minion to dodge out away from Haunter, not allowing for the counter kill and going Q back in for the extra one. He did miss one stun there onto Haunter.
Yep.
But other than that, I think he has been very intelligent in how he's using his Q resets on those minions.
Tragically for Golden Guardians, that was also the Predator from Contrax as he was walking up to try to get to the fight in time. 0-for-3 so far on those activations, not managing to get himself involved in anything the team has done, really.
Yeah, I mean, it is a fairly low cooldown. It's not like this is a huge thing, but what you keep pointing out because it's indicative of...
Are your ganks working?
Exactly.
The answer is no.
A fairly non-threatening Predator. Here we go, though. Circling up onto the tower once again. That tower can't run away from it.
Golden Guardians trying to get some of that play money. They know they lost all of their own on the bottom side tier one. They're trying to get some back. Equalizer finds its way onto the entirety of the team, and Vulcan is just dialing these hooks in, but he is overextended, and Golden Guardians find the counterattack.
Yep, congratulations, you played yourself. You got the hook in, but Nautilus also takes it, and then who he able to get up the Braum shield. It's called Unbreakable for a reason, Flowers. Four people throwing everything they have at Braum, and yet it's the Nautilus that goes down first. Golden Guardians will claim the dragon as their reward.
What a big reward it is, too, when you have a team that is so heavily skewed towards damage. And Aatrox in the top lane, and AP Gragas in the jungle. Everybody's going to be benefiting from this Infernal Drake as they move forward. Let's take another look at how Clutch just went too far.
All right, so Huni does get the slow. That allows for the initiation from Vulcan. But even with Aftershock, it was a great Gragas ultimate from Contrax. Contrax splits up the whole team and knocks Vulcan into the Golden Guardians. That is the exact type of Gragas ultimate that you wish for. Splitting up the entire team, getting one member into yours to solo out. So I think that for all the fun that you're making of the Predator use from Contrax there, you should also give him some props for that ulti.
All right, the ulti was solid. If we get the Predators up to the level of the ulti, Golden Guardians are going to be in business. Nice. I'm not making fun, I'm stating facts. They are different things. But one thing that they are making sure they're keeping track of here is those red buffs. Contract's not going to allow that one to be stolen away. While topside, Bond is going in for the solo kill. Not quite able to find those skill shots and bring Huni down. Hero shows up, but honestly,
wait,
this is Cinder Hulk Jarvan. He's not going to do a lot. That doesn't seem like it was the right button.
That was an intimidation control word right there.
I've never used a control word to intimidate an opponent before. That's a new one.
Well, maybe you didn't because it doesn't work. Hunter just killed off the ward. No harm,
swing
no foul, though.
But hey, at least he gave it a shot. Golden Guardians now moving up to the enemy red buff, stealing that one away, trying to pass it off to FBI. Should have no problem doing that. Rin secures it there for Kalista. Still one turret to zero in the favor of Clutch Gaming. Although Golden Guardians got that tier one in the mid lane down low, they were not able to finish off the kill. And Haunter, now buying that time in the top side, made it so Froggen was able to get himself some damage onto the bottom lane tier one there.
All right, Contrax trying to fight with Demonte over the chickens. Gets one more small one. Meanwhile, mid lane FBI, looks like they've got their sights set on him. Hui with the Zonyas. Stopwatch activation already just kind of breaks his watch.
I don't think that was the right button either.
All right, we've definitely had a lot of misclicks so far in quick succession.
Yeah.
And that is a very valuable tool. The Flowers, I know you hold very close to your heart.
Yeah.
One broken stopwatch.
These things are worth a lot. These change games, man. But not when they happen to go off accidentally.
Yeah, not quite the game-changing stopwatch that he was hoping for with that one.
No. Sometimes it doesn't go the way you want it to, but Clutch Gaming are now trying to find themselves another turret. They took out the tier ones in the side lanes, take down this one in mid, get some more map control. That's the name of the game. FBI would like to stop that from happening, but the Equalizer will zone them away for now. Lyra throws down the flag just to give some extra attack speed, but it's not quite enough to let Clutch Gaming finish the objective away.
You see how liberally Huni just uses these Rumble ultimates, fairly low cooldown on it. He's level 6 now, so he uses the Rumble ultimate there. There's only 1 minute left on the cooldown already to get the summoner spell heal out of FBI at the tower and push them off of the tower a little bit to get some more damage on it.
And even with no cooldown, just having the rank 2 in the ultimate, he's got an 85-second cooldown at max. So, minute and a half, doesn't feel too bad to fling that thing out trying to take down the tier 1. Looking at the rest of the itemization coming across the board for these guys, Huni did go ahead and go for the Oblivion Orb right after Liandry. Still needs to get the Sorc Shoes to get the double penetration online, but Demonte's got the Trinity Force for Irelia. Pretty big power spike there, one of the best single item power spikes in League of Legends. Across the board, Blade of the Ruined Kings popping off for both AD carries to shred through some of this health being stacked on solo laners and jungler alike.
Yeah, remember we were talking about last time where Golden Guardians have a very strong Tristana at their disposal. Once again, this time around, it's Froggen piloting the Tristana, but the story is the same. They've got a lot of money on the Tristana. He has a huge CS lead, bunch of turret plate money as well from early in the game, which doesn't show up in any of the stats. However, once he goes back and is able to complete the rapid fire cannon, it will show up in the items.
Bogtrak's eating a little damage from the Boomerang Blade there. Takes a sip just to try to top some of his health back off. Golden Guardians, four men defending here in the mid lane. Haunster going back to base to grab his items, grab some control wards. You can see two in the inventory there. As now Clutch Gaming may be looking to start up a fight, but I think they learned their lesson well last time, my friend. Braum is not the target.
Yeah. Definitely going to think twice this time around. There's a lot of things you have to think about.
Uh-oh, here we go. They're thinking about going in. Never mind. Here we go. Clutch Gaming trying to start this one off. But FBI with a good save onto Huhi. You've always got to respect that when Kalista's in the game.
Yep. Able to save his lane partner there. But the damage, decent damage has been dealt. The ultimate from Kalista is a huge cooldown. And 50% HP on two members now.
Huhi once again. Very low. Nice cask. Contracts is making these count. Vulcan taking it down to 100 HP. Both sides are limping away from this fight.
That's enough for Clutch to earn themselves the Drake, though, uncontested. They dealt enough damage to earn the Infernal Drake. No kills acquired in the mid-fight. However, Infernal Drakes will now be split one apiece.
Haunster goes over the wall right as one of his opponents is getting back. Huni's still left here in the bottom side. Cody Sun giving some free firing time over the mid lane tier one means Clutch Gaming will finally take out that last remaining link in the chain of outer turrets and buy themselves a little bit more map control.
All right, that's gonna really open it up here since the dragon has already been taken down too. It's now time to start to move over towards this Baron area. A lot of these defenses being down for Golden Guardians makes it a little bit more difficult for them, so they have to get up more of this vision around the Baron pit, around mid lane, to kind of stabilize and make sure that Clutch do not start to run away with it.
Clutch have bought themselves a nice little lead here. Morello Nomicon now done for the Rumble, too, means any sort of healing done through
Aatrox,
Kalista. Aatrox, Gragas, Kalista, and Tristana also both having Blade of the Ruined Kings. Very effective purchase here this game. We'll see how well he can continue to aim these equalizers. We're into the mid-game part very convincingly now. We're going to see pretty much 5v5s all the time, and that means these equalizers will have a huge amount to say in terms of who's going to win that fight.
All right, and that rapid fire cannon I was talking about has been completed on Froggen for the Tristana, so if they bring the Tristana down, then they can actually look for that 5-on-5. The Kalista ultimate is key, though, and once again, it's still not back off of cooldown. 15 more seconds left on FBI's cooldown here. Haunster has been able to travel over. And as soon as they finish this one up, that might be the go.
There we go yet again. It's Vulcan turning things on. Over the wall comes Damante, and FBI's having a flash away. Equalizer comes down. They're looking to zone Huhi out now as well. Froggen taken very low. He's going to burn down to the Ignite. Haunster walks out with a World Ender active. Huhi's still turning back away, but Lyra has the kill. And Clutch Gaming fine too.
Clutch looks so clean in these fights. FBI dashes away from Damante, and he gets out with his life. But two members of Golden Guardians are down. And Clutch have control over Baron Pit.
This is where I want to see these teams fighting for a spot in playoffs prove that they deserve to go to playoffs. You got the two kills. Let's see the Baron call, and let's see it clean. Contracts is still alive. You have to respect the ability for the steal to come online. Damante moving around from behind. There's your stun. There's your damage. There's a one-for-one so far. Haunster goes over the wall, but he's going to continue to be chased down. More damage piling in, but back of the wall he goes, and Cody Sun says, no, you don't.
Flash over the wall there for Cody to finish up the extra kill. Golden Guardians do stop the Baron, definitely at a very big cost, though, as Clutch are able to increase their gold lead with some extra money. Now let's see what that turns into. Control wards stacked down the line now as every member of Clutch fills up on vision, and they are going to return to that objective. All right, let's take another look here at the team fight. Vulcan starts it out with the hook over the wall. Damante gets the ult on FBI, forces the flash super early on. Then you see them dash out to the opposite side, but Huni in there, and Lyra is able to get in and dunk Froggen. What a combination. That burn from the Leandres as well from Huni, still barely on Froggen, I believe, to finish up the kill after the dunk. Here's another look at the Baron. We know that Damante's on the top of your screen, comes down and tries to finish off Contracts. That was the goal, to kill off the jungler, but because that Gragas barrel also killed off Vulcan, they're just trying to pick up extra kills here. They won't return to the Baron. Dakota's Sun gonna flash over to secure an extra one.
Extra kill going the way of Clutch Gaming. More money there for Cody, who's almost at that big three-item point on the Sivir. Clutch Gaming with a 3,500 gold lead, too, means I want to continue seeing these guys push the pace of the game, and they're going to push that pace straight into FBI. You remember what I said about Kalista? You remember what I said about point and click? Point, click, see you later. Now the fight's going to keep on going, but Contracts turns it around and finds yet another kill onto Vulcan. Hooney's going to be isolated at the back end of the fight, and Haunter will just barely miss out of the kill, but it's a double over to Contracts. Golden Guardians are doing a hell of a job fighting back. It's a 2-for-2 so far, and Froggen's not looking to stop. Damonte gets a stun, but Froggen rocket jumps forward, flashing more for the auto attacks, and there's your shutdown. Golden Guardians win the fight.
Golden Guardians also getting some very important kill credit money. The bounty has been taken off of Damonte's head right here. That was a big cash in, and it went to the right place. Froggen on the Tristana flashes forward for the last auto to finish up that kill. This is a crazy spread out fight. So at the beginning, you're talking about they all focus on FBI. They know there's no flash on the Kalista, but then Clutch actually go too deep. They engage on the Braum once again. Yes, they do force Huhi out to the top side, but everyone splits. Haunter deals so much damage to Huhi, he basically chases him off there, allowing Contracts to pick up the kill. And Damonte actually missed his ultimate on the top side of the screen on the Braum that you can see there. That allowed Froggen to rocket jump in onto Damonte, knowing that he does not have his ultimate available, and chase down that extra kill, get the extra bounty money for himself. And now Tristana, working towards the Infinity Edge, has a lot more flat AD.
Clutch Gaming's gonna have to pump those brakes when they see Braum standing in the middle of the road like this over and over again. You've got to stop running after this guy. As Lyra walks up, ends up face checking the brush. Cody's son popping the all in the hunt, but Lyra has already retreated with the combo, meaning Clutch Gaming doesn't really have a chance to try to turn this one around. Both sides gonna back away there. Cody's son clearing out the control ward, grabbing a little bit of damage with the ricochet as well. Better used there by Contract, but not going to find much. I just had to point that out.
A story as old as time.
Yes, sir. Contract's Predator not finding the mark. But I do want to give him credit. As you said earlier, his ult in a lot of these fights are keeping Golden Guardians in the game because he's the one isolating targets. He's the one making sure that they're getting these kills and going even or close to even in fights that Clutch Gaming are starting off well in their own favor.
Yeah, it's very important AP damage for the team as well. Haunter gets the Infernal Chain Q3 combo once again. Huni down to 60% HP, but he's got defenses here with the rest of the team because Clutch Gaming have taken over so much of this blue quadrant of the jungle. They are able to allow Huni this extra push power. They mine the extra camps here as well, taking away those wolves, and Damonte getting it done.
Froggen is fearless. He says, you're an Irelia, I'm an AD carry, and I do not care. Continuing to walk forward with those items. Almost has the Infinity Edge ready to go here on the Trist as well. Bottom side too, I also want to point out, if you look at Haunter's inventory, he has the Caulfield's Warhammer for the Death's Dance that you normally see on Aatrox. Also has both of the ingredients for a Spirit Visage though. Very effective item on Aatrox, amps the healing, makes you tankier, gives you cooldown reduction, but up against the squad of Clutch Gaming, it's only helping against the Rumble. So that means he's investing a lot of money for only that, as now another team fight's breaking out. Lyra's on the retreat. Golden Guardians find themselves a little bit of time, but a nice equalizer is going to find its way onto multiple Guardians, and now Damonte is coming in from the flank. Shutdown credit over to him, but he will fall. Froggen makes the kill happen, but where's the fight going to go from there? Lyra says straight into the ground, and a double kill goes the way of Huni. Ace, Clutch, Gaming!
And Clutch Gaming want that playoff spot. Baron will be their reward. What a team fight. Damonte teleports in behind the rest of them. He goes down as the sacrifice, but they will be happy wearing purple.
Clutch Gaming find the big fight, they find the big reward, and the game is theirs to take now. Let's take another look at the fight.
Hook from Vulcan, this time onto Contracts, forces the Zonyas. Then FBI goes in, they get some decent damage onto Lyra, but with the teleports coming in, Huni, huge Rumble ultimate, and Damonte with the flank. Irelia is able to get the kill onto Contracts, plus slow the rest of the team. After that, it is a 3v4, but Haunter goes in on the 3v4. Froggen can't do enough damage from the back line, and Clutch bursts him down.
Clutch Gaming with that Baron buff ready to go. Already 6,500 gold lead. They have all tier twos left to claim. Let's see how they set up these lanes, how they want to facilitate this push. We've seen Huni continuing to split push throughout the game, then joining the fights for the big equalizers. He'll continue to set up shop here bottom side. You can see the rest of Clutch working through the enemy jungle, taking the blue buff, sitting down the vision, making Golden Guardians afraid to come out and defend these turrets.
Yep, turret's starting to go down here. Tower aggro is grabbed due to the flamethrower there from Huni, but the tower is going to melt just the same.
Haunster having to walk back away from Lyra here, who's honestly not doing a whole lot other than buffing up the minions, but that's all he needs to do, just waste Haunster's time, make it take an excessively long period to clear out those minion waves. Lyra continues to back up. The rest of the Golden Guardians will continue to contest the bottom lane tier 3 turret. They've got the cannon minion firing away at this one. A couple more auto attacks should finish it off. They may not even need
Boom.
To. The barrel's not going to do enough work, and with the turret down, the inhibitor is now exposed, and Clutch Gaming are daring Golden Guardians to fight them on open ground. Lyra's going to be pulled back by the chain. Froggen coming out of the base now as well. Lyra taking a little bit of damage. There's no Warmogs on this Jarvan. He won't be able to regenerate, but now the On the Hunt's going to be popped. Huni having to back himself away. Equalizer burns them down, and Huni goes on a rampage. FBI's out of the picture, and the minion wave crashes through the bottom lane gates. Inhibitor taken out.
What great ult usage from Clutch there to take down the Kalista once again. Every time FBI does not have Flash, they are all looking for him. It is Nautilus ultimate into the Rumble ultimate and Irelia ultimate, all finding those hits onto FBI, taking out the heart of the Golden Guardian squad. And without the extra ultimate and CC from Kalista, they can't hope to win this team fight. Yeah, Froggen can do a lot of damage with Tristana if there's an opening, if there's time and CC for the Tristana to work around, but they just have not been able to construct their team fight, and Clutch have been too fast at swarming in.
Yeah, Clutch Gaming doing a good job with this Baron so far. They've already got themselves over 2,500 gold with the extra inhibitor pressure from it. Still 30 more seconds to work with as everybody gets themselves back out onto the map. We'll see if they can take another tier two before that buff wears away. But Golden Guardians are just trying to regain their footing at this point, placing down all these defensive wards in their own jungle, trying to keep an eye on Clutch Gaming. But Clutch is being vigilant in clearing that vision away. They will miss the one ward there in the brush to the side of the red buff, but Huni will continue to push up here towards the tier two in the top side. With the rest of Clutch showing up, they're trying to brute force this one down, and they will get away with it.
All right, that's one tower down. Clutch not gonna stop there. Cannon minion is buffed up, trying to move it in. The Baron buff expires and Vulcan is ghost!
That was not the play, my friend. He hooks himself into the turret, gets exploded immediately, and Huni will barely survive the burn damage from the Liandry's equalizer.
The floor is lava. Everybody get out. That Rumble ultimate hurts, even though they had already just lost Vulcan without anyone in exchange. You can see how difficult it will be for the Golden Guardian squad to deal with Huni's solo AP threats. Really like it when Clutch basically build team comps with him as the only AP threat on the Rumble, because it really forces a diversification in the enemy itemization, and it is really, really taking a toll.
Vulcan has been such a double-edged sword for Clutch Gaming this game, and both sides of that sword are damn sharp, because he's the one who's caught people out multiple times with really good hooks, but he's also the guy who's hooked into Braum twice for losing fights and hooked into that turret once to give away a free kill and stop their own push. I'm really liking how aggressive he is and how well he's aiming the hooks. He just needs to temper that a little bit.
So teams put priority on all the champions in the game for their team fights, just to have as a list, Captain Flower. So
okay.
If you're going to make a priority list for your team fight with the Golden Guardians, Skarner is not in the game.
Oh, I thought you meant for your draft.
I appreciate the enthusiasm, as always, and the love for Skarner. Your undying devotion there is always on display. But Braum is below zero place here on the priority.
Below zero place.
Below zero place, because not only is it the least threatening champion on the Golden Guardians that also has the most defensive abilities itself, but it's also attached to Kalista. So there is no world where you should ever be going for Braum first in these team fights. You're actually just wasting anything that you use on the champion.
We'll see if Clutch Gaming can refine that as they move forward. They're still sitting on an incredible lead of 8,000 gold. They've got equal ground in terms of Infernal Drakes with their opponents, but they've got 3 Cloud Drakes. If they even start to win a fight, they will be able to run the Golden Guardians down very easily. Just look at how fast Hooney's moving around here on this Rumble. Of course, that's also with a Scrap Shield engaged. Contracts looking for the opportunity to find initiation here, but I'm not even gonna say it. I'm just gonna, you know what I'm gonna say?
Oh, fair enough. All right, Baron's about to spawn though. I will say it, Clutch Gaming already have the control wards leading up to that Baron. This is what you want to do in this red quadrant of the jungle. Exactly, really good toggle here by the observers. It's so dark. Golden Guardians know it is really scary and difficult for them to get into this position.
Clutch Gaming have sounded the battle cry. Stivers going in, FBI doing a good job keeping Hoohe alive here yet again. Dredgeline would have found its way onto the Braum once more, but it's FBI who's continuously targeted. Hooney's gonna be knocked away. He's kept safe for now. Taken very, very low though. Golden Guardians do a good job disengaging this one, but considering the only guy they get low has a teleport, Clutch can still start the Baron up.
Yep, FBI goes back to the fountain to heal. Clutch gonna use that teleport. Hooney's behind them. No ultimate available for the Rumble just yet, and they go for it.
Here comes the pincer attack. Clutch Gaming starting things off here. Hooney over the wall. He's found his way onto Froggen. He goes into the stasis to buy a little bit of extra time. Damante continues diving forward, but he may have gone a little bit too far. He's taken into the Guardian Angel. The resurrection comes through. Golden Guardians still trying to grab themselves a kill. FBI's throwing the spears, and there's a kill for Froggen. FBI's taken down, though, and the Golden Guardians are finding themselves on the wrong end of the fight.
Back-to-back Creed plays right there, and that might be Clutch Gaming inside the base. Cody Sun teleports in, and he's on the Nexus turret.
Clutch Gaming are hungry for that playoff spot. Froggen and Contracts, the only thing that could possibly stop them, but the Equalizer will deny that opportunity. Clutch Gaming have earned themselves a spot in the playoffs.
Congratulations to Clutch. They have dealt with a lot over the course of this year.
Yes,
and
sir.
They come out on top just in time here, making it into playoffs and in the best form that we have seen all summer.
Yeah, that's what I was saying coming into this game. For squads like this that have been middle of the pack for most of the split, I want to see them hit that peak right now. That's the chance you're going to have to compete in these playoffs. And again, I really liked how aggressively Clutch were playing. Even if some of the engages were onto the wrong targets, they were never sitting around just waiting for things to transpire, playing that scale up to 45 minutes till we have 4 items kind of game. They were always wanting to push the issue. Cody Sun, 4-0-12 on this Sivir. As soon as they saw they had the chance, it was almost like a traffic light. As soon as Vulcan's ult went off, that's green, baby. That means go. On the Hunt gets popped. Everybody goes in. Equalizer comes down. It was a good game.
Yep. Get that Nautilus ultimate down on the Kalista. She can't get out of the Rumble ultimate, and it would burn up to 70, 80% of the HP off that Kalista with just a couple ults targeting her in the late game in those team fights. So if there's no flash, then there's no escape.
I mean, that's the power of what Rumble can do, right? You've got extra burn with Liandry's. You've already got the slow built in thanks to what Equalizer is. Double spell pen. It's a bad day to be a Kalista, but it's a good day for Clutch Gaming. Now, Letigris is standing by with Vulcan to hear about making his very first playoffs.
The first playoffs are a great playoff, I'm sure. But first things first, after having an entire split of being described as the bar, everyone above or below, what does this mean to you to officially be in this playoff position?
It feels really good, honestly, because I feel like for a while, Clutch Gaming is kind of getting, like, it's just under the radar. No one really expects us to do good. We're just like the team that can do good versus bottom teams, and then we'll lose to top teams. And it feels really good to prove that we actually deserve a chance at like the big games. And then it's also my first playoffs, so I'm really excited to like see how we'll do and just be in higher pressure situations.
And you earned your way there. A lot of aggressive play coming from you during this game, some hooks that were imperative to the overall victory. So is this aggressive style something that you're becoming more comfortable with, something we might see a bit more?
I think as a team, we're really just focusing on always fighting on our terms. So if we see a play, we want to engage first so that the team is not as prepared as it would be if they were the one going in. So I'm always looking for if we're there, if we're ready, I'll start the fights and make sure like those are fights we're going to win. And it's on like I won that fight. Let's fucking go.
Hey, let's go. And last thing for you is the fact that you're just saying how everyone kind of expects Clutch to just be there, and this is the chance to be there in the playoffs. But what do you have to say to all those haters that kind of wrote you off then?
I don't care about the haters or anything. I'm just extremely happy to be in the playoffs, finally.
All positive vibes here on the stage. So for more positivity and maybe a little hate, we'll have to see. Let's send it over to the State Farm Analyst Desk.
Thank you, LaTigress. Clutch Gaming, they locked themselves fifth place into the postseason and pushed Golden Guardians into that three-way tie for sixth. They'll be playing a game later to see if they can snag the last and final spot in the postseason. But it was great to hear from Vulcan there. Smile on the face, just happy to have asserted themselves as deserving of their playoff bye and looking forward to the competition of the postseason.
I mean, climbing all the way to fifth now as the final standing for them is crazy when you're talking about, like, oh, yeah, they have a shot at playoffs. And now they are the team that is actually solidified in with a ton of tiebreakers to go. It shows how hard they have been peaking at the end of the season.
I mean, they look really good as a team. It's not that one player has been hard carrying them. Individually, they are stepping up, but every single play really looks to be exactly the philosophy that Vulcan was talking about. Engaging first, utilizing their abilities to collapse sooner to catch the opponents off guard. And with Golden Guardians, a team that has been struggling to fight as five, as we saw yesterday, that caught them up time and time again.
And I know you both predicted this matchup, but Crumbs, you in particular, earlier today on Countdown when we were talking about Golden Guardians versus Clutch, you were very vocal about, I am worried for Golden Guardians in this matchup, and throwing a lot of your weight behind a Clutch that has really been increasing in power throughout the split. And so once again, very exciting to see them act on a lot of what they've been talking about, act on a lot of the characteristics of these players that we know to be true. Huni, Demonte, aggressive players. Support them in their aggression. Get players like Vulcan, champions that can enable that. Yeah. And you see what kind of results that bears.
I mean, and Demonte had just an exceptional Irelia game. I know that we're going to look at the end of game score and look at why did he get out CS. Well, it's you got Sivers. She was taking all the CS. Simultaneously, you got FBI that got kind of missed out on all the CS because Froggen was getting it. But look at how quickly Clutch Gaming actually is already committing more members. Who needs here way?
He already
TP'd before. Is here. And this is exactly what I'm talking about. They are way more willing to fight together than Golden Guardians. Once again here, it looks like a terrible mistake. Right? And yeah.
This one is so good. He hops in first to get the kill using the creeps.
Watch this.
Does have to fight Haunter 1v1 here. Dodges all the sweet spots. And then this Q to a creep to dodge the third potential sweet spot is so good.
Yes, he missed the E, but we'll forgive him because the rest of that fancy
Yeah! Yeah, I love it!
Dodging sweet spots like, here we go, straight into the playoffs. That was the early game. Definitely
he carried the early game.
Oh,
the
absolutely. Yeah. He was, what, like 4-1-4 or 4-0-4 through the early game.
Yeah.
Definitely racking it up. You did mention, though, the CS lead for Frog, and I think that is important to know only because the gold differential between the teams wasn't insane, you know, in the earlier portions of the game, maybe a 2 to 3K gold lead moving into the mid game. And so there was still a lot of work that Clutch had to do within the team fights to really begin to build that separation.
And a great aspect of their composition is that when you're up against double carries like the Tristana or the Kalista, you Nautilus Ultimate into whatever else you have. They didn't have the equalizer here because Rumble wasn't in range, but we saw later time and time again, you drop that and the stun, and in that time before you drop, you're dead as a carry. You can't afford to take that, and it's uncounterable. You really don't have a way out, and so they continue to play really, really well, and this is Tanner once again making some big moves as the team doesn't suspect that there's going to be an Irelia in the rush.
I mean, this was one of those games, like the previous game, where so many people stepped up. We talked about Demonte in the early game. Vulcan had some absolutely incredible hooks over the course of this game. You saw another one right there, and then later on in the game, it was actually, I think, Huni ended up with the most kills in the game.
And I know we got something cool about Cody's son.
Oh, we'll talk about him.
All right,
let's hold it. We still got one more to get through here, Crumbs. That would be the ace that secures the Baron for Clutch Gaming here. So once again, Baron River, big hook to start it off by Vulcan.
Look at
and
the
this
TP.
Will be a clean five.
Look at what Irelia does, because she's basically sacrificing herself with an unreal stun. Catches everybody and then buys just enough time for the carries and everybody else to position nicely and do a lot of damage. And look at Froggen can't actually hit anybody into that ward, into that brush on the right left side of mid lane because there's no ward. Somebody needed to drop a control ward there so that Tristana could take advantage of the range. They didn't, and that's the kind of plays that you gotta assist your teammates. It's kind of like when a Lee Sin doesn't have a ward on him, and as an ally, you drop a ward for him, you give him the ward hop for free. That's what you gotta do with your carries.
Now for the fun around Cody's son. The guy is deathless in the last 5 games for Clutch Gaming. And this has gone, I think, unnoticed till this point.
That's what I want to talk about, is because we're talking about, oh, they're so aggressive, they're doing so well. Like, one of the things when you have multiple aggressive people is you almost always need one person. There are, like, the transcendent teams who everyone can play aggressive, but most teams need some kind of rock somewhere on the team, and that's Cody. The fact that you have all these people diving in, the enemy team doesn't ever get a chance to actually kill your marksman. So you're killing theirs, and yours is always alive. Cody has been incredible and has no laning phase deaths, which means the lane's going well, team fight's going well. It's an incredible show, and it's obviously not just on him.
Right.
The team sets him up well as well.
And you know, it really is that Vulcan is so outrageously aggressive in the lane and outside of it that you always forget about Cody being there, because he just has to follow Vulcan. He never has to set up the play himself.
Buys him so much space. And these aren't like, oh, 0-11 score lines.
Yeah.
Just reciting a few of them, going 5 games back, 904, 101, 408, 603, and then this game on top of it. That's nearing a 50 KDA across 5 games with 0 deaths, so it's really awesome to see that. Again, alongside the improvements that Clutch has made, I think, as you mentioned, dark horse for playoffs. This is going to be the team to keep your eye on for upsets when it comes to the playoffs. Time for a quick commercial break. After that, it's Game 5, Echo Fox versus FlyQuest, ahead of the tiebreaker matches. We'll see you here after this.
Damante rotating around, trying to join the fight before it's too late. Hooney's dropped the equalizer. FBI is down. Long range hook onto the enemy mid laner. Still looking to find the damage here. One more auto attack should seal the deal.
Gragas is dead, Gragas is dead.
Yeah. I'm just walking up, okay. I'm not scared. I'm not
Don't flash on the Aatrox, don't flash.
I'm going to heal, airbound.
I'm going to press B, kill him back.
Don't bait. Kill this.
Look at Jarvan, just look at Jarvan. Sivan and flash, he can't get in. We're on Rumble, guys.
Yeah.
Rumble's on here.
I got him.
Nice!
Froggen makes the kill happen, but where's the fight gonna go from there? Lyra says straight into the ground, and a double kill goes the way of Hooney! Ace, Clutch, Gaming!
Play with
Sivir. Kill the Nexus, please!
This is dead,
This is dead, full hit!
I'm right clicking the Nexus.
Let's go!
You got your own car with your own insurance.
Thanks, Steph. No more driving that old hand-me-down.
Surprise! No, I'm not gonna get a date in this.
We had a lot of great dates in this car.
No, no. Ew.